Yeah, during that very last number of okay.
So Nayak, how many are the total registered participants?
Yeah, nearly 260-270.
Oh, okay.
Okay, but they will join slowly. We'll start up.
That's yeah, in the middle they may join.
So well, shall we start?
Yes, sir. Please continue. Please start introduction.
Yeah, well, good afternoon to all. It is my pleasure to introduce you all that Dr. M.R. Umesh. Dr. M.R. Umesh is working as assistant professor at University of Agricultural Sciences, Raichur, and he has completed all his B.Sc., M.Sc. Agriculture and Ph.D. from Agriculture University, Bangalore, Karnataka. Then he also completed a postdoc fellow from USA. Then he is working since 2011 as assistant professor at the University of Agricultural Sciences, Raichur. And he is a very dynamic young scientist. He has got lot of good awards, and also he has published so many research papers in national and international level journals. If I want to mention few awards of Dr. Umesh, he has received a incentive award in the year 2014, and he has received the IPNI award in the year 2010-13 from International Plant Nutrition Institute, USA. And he has also received many best poster and best presentation awards from the CREDA Hyderabad and various other international conferences. And he also received the Travel Fellowship Award, then PPIC Fellowship, University Merit Scholarship, Jindal Merit Scholarship, and there are many such top level awards he has been received, and he also received many international level projects also from DST DBT and many other prestigious institute projects he has also been handled. And his area of teaching is the principles and practices of soil fertility and nutrient management, rainfed agriculture and watershed management, irrigation water management, and modern concepts in crop production. And he has also attended a few international trainings. Then he has published about 57 papers in the national journals, book chapters about 20 numbers. He edited about 4 books on his own in his research area. The extended summary and abstract about 30 numbers. Then he has visited United States of America, then Philippines, United Kingdom. And likewise, his beta, you keep on reading, it is very lengthy. So I just made it very brief. So Dr. Umesh is a very dynamic scientist at U.S. Raichur. He is like a sensor-based agronomist and very well-known scientist in all over world. So I take the opportunity to thank Dr. Umesh for taking this responsibility. I hand over the mic to Dr. Umesh now. Dr. Umesh, please.
Chandranayak, thank you for your brief introduction. And I will start my presentation.
Yeah. Okay, Dr. Sir. Good luck.
Okay. So, good afternoon, each one of you present over online. And so I think it's like a good afternoon and a good after good lunch. I think nobody will sleep for my presentation. I will take very briefly. So what I want to discuss or share my knowledge over 10 years in the US Raichur and some experience from abroad. Crop livestock environmental interactions in relation to nutrient management and climate change. So like whatever we got one DST Department of Science and Technology funded projects from New Delhi under a young scientist project. What are the like brief we have done over 4 years in related to climate change? I wanted to share that knowledge also, and some of the information it is already developed or shared, published from the literature also I took. And this 1 hour I will going to share all this information. Basically, we know, all of us know, causes and consequences of climate change, whether it is a abiotic factors or the biotic factors, altogether it like resulted in the severe climate change, whether it is from natural factors or human made factors. Okay, so overall, whether it is from the different factors, ultimately it is related to or impacted on the climate change. So consequently, of all what we are interested in agriculture, ultimately these climate change and the natural factors is resulted in crop yield losses. Everybody is talking about the climate change, how it is and why it is initially it was started. Like greenhouse effect, the concept is way back. The solar radiation, it is passes through the clear atmosphere. When there is no obstructions or any gas layer on the atmosphere, it is whatever the radiation it is emitted from the sun, it is absorbed by the earth in the form of energy. So all of us know, like, it is only one energy source for like a terrestrial ecosystem, and part of it is absorbed and reflected back to absorbed and remaining is reflected back to the atmosphere, and it is very scattered. The major problem with this, in the atmospheric layer there is some part of the infrared radiation is absorbed and emitted back to the atmosphere. The problem with the greenhouse gases, these emitted back to the atmosphere, it is restricted because of these layers. Okay, so that is why it is started the warming up of the climate. This is the finally the basic concepts in the climate change. Then what are the consequences in the climate change case, like changing in the rain and the snow pattern across in different parts of the world? Then frequently we also observed stronger storms. Then on the terrace, like aquatic ecosystem, damaged coral leaves and rising sea level, then warmer oceans. Okay, so we know like why it is very important when the ocean is warm up, because of some of the many of the aquatic the animals or the living organisms will severely affected by warming up of the oceans. Then finally, it is also consequences from the higher temperature and more heat waves in the city, like urban areas, and in the agricultural land, more droughts and wildfires is also observed, and some of them are like less snow and ice burning, like melting of the snow is also consequences of the climate change. All these put together, that is leading to the climate change, ultimately in the form of the global warming. So what are these elements which are directly responsible for the climate change? One such gases are the greenhouse gases. Okay, so if you look at the major gases, the carbon dioxide, the methane, nitrous oxide. So among the carbon dioxide is the maximum, because before the industrialization or the era of the urbanization, the carbon dioxide is not a much problem. So we know it is started from 177 ppm, and it may reaches now it is up to 410 or 420 ppm. Okay, so as long as the carbon dioxide emitted from the industries, it is going to increase further and further. The carbon dioxide is the main source is from the industries, and methane and nitrous oxide is from the agricultural fields. Okay, so these individual the greenhouse gases we are going to discuss in details in the subsequent slides. Okay, so first one is the carbon dioxide. The carbon dioxide, it is very, very strong the atomic bonds. It can form a stable compounds compared to any other the greenhouse gases. The carbon can form the covalent bonds to as many as four other atoms. That's why it is very, very strong, and these other the greenhouse gases are converted into the carbon dioxide equivalent. Okay, so what it means and how it is calculated, I'm going to show in the subsequent slides. Okay, so these are the atomic structure of the N2O, the CH4 and CO2. So what are those major other than the carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide? Then fluorocarbons also plays a role in the greenhouse gas. then if you look at the source wise or sector wise, how much is the contribution of different the sectors for the climate change? It is only taken into consider the greenhouse gas emissions. Okay, like the industry is only 19.4%, agriculture food 13.5%, then forestry, the wastewater, the waste solid waste and the wastewater, it is constitute only 2.8%. Then energy sector. So look at the other than these sectors, energy sectors contribute 25.9%. Then transport 13%. Then remaining rest is 7.9%. Okay. So these are the major sectors which contribute for the world climate change. So look at the major, the big like country where it is the maximum area and where it contributes. Like over years from 1990 up to 2017, the carbon dioxide is the major problem with the US. Okay. So I told already the carbon dioxide is the main from the industries, not from the agriculture. Like US is contributing more towards from the industries CO2 emission. Likewise, the methane, nitrous oxide and fluorinated gases. And the methane is very, very less. Okay, because it is not that much intensive agriculture area. So like industries are the major ones. Then sector wise, the greenhouse gas emissions, then the transportation, electricity generation, industries, agriculture, commercial and residential. Okay, so first two, one is transportation and the electricity generation are the major one, the followed by industry. Okay, so not the agriculture. So what we all scientists, we are listening today, you can see agriculture is not a major contributor for the greenhouse gas emission. Okay, so like everybody say like agriculture is contributing more and more, not that one. It is other than agriculture, the other three industry like source sectors also contribute more towards the greenhouse gas emission. Okay. So over periodical changes in greenhouse gas emission in USA, you can see how it is going to change carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide and fluorinated gases over years. Then total greenhouse gases. So in the middle of 2000 to 2005, it was more, then it is gradually stagnating or little bit at the lower rate. So decreasing at the lower rate. Then livestock. So livestock based the greenhouse gas emission in US is also very, very important. It is maximum, it is from the beef cattle, dairy cattle, then followed by a very small portion. Okay. So beef cattle is the biggest one and dairy cattle followed by dairy cattle. Okay. So if like Western or Northern USA, Northern America, where the people are more depending upon the wheat, depends the food on the wheat and beef. So that makes more towards the greenhouse gas emission. Okay. Then if you look at the livestock production, the sources wise, within the livestock production, how these bifurcated into different concepts, like the fermentation contributes 44%, then manure left on the pastures. Okay, grazing is the major ones in worldwide. It is 17%. Then manure management. So the ideal or the good management of manure is also important. It will contribute 8%. Then, so the manure, it is directly applied to soil. It is only 2%. Then like synthetic fertilizers, 15% and so on. So among different category of animals, like what I explained in the previous slide, it is dairy cattle 55%. It is overall world. I'm talking about the livestock production from the world. So the global distribution of methane emission from the manure. So where you see, you can see like where it is more concentrated, it is in the China, like India and parts of like African countries and European countries and majorly in US. Okay. So wherever the intense, the red color you see, those are the spots where like maximum production of a maximum emission of the methane from the manure. Then the sources of 30% of the total global anthropogenic emissions of the greenhouse gases, that also includes, one is the particular particulate matter and the greenhouse gases from land clearance, burning of residues, then the forest fire also contribute for the greenhouse gases. Then anthropogenic emissions including the rice and livestock production and the fertilizers and manure. Then direct and indirect sources of agriculture and greenhouse emission. So there are within the agriculture, like what are those? The nitrous oxide from soils, then methane from cattle, enteric fermentation. Those two are major contributors. Then followed by the biomass burning. These are converted into CO2 equivalents. So what it means, I will going to explain in the subsequent slides. Like if you remember, these two are the major ones. Yeah. So some of the terminologies used in the climate change. So if you look at the definition of what given NASA USA, it is a broad range of global phenomena created predominantly burning the fossil fuels, then heat trapping gases on the earth surface. These phenomena also includes temperature trends by the global warming, and it also encompasses the changes the sea level, ice mass loss, or like melting of ice caps in Greenland and Antarctica, and the mountain glaciers worldwide. Then shifting the plant behavior in the extreme weather conditions. So these are the very comprehensive definition of climate change. It take into consideration all the aspects of like earth, the atmosphere, agriculture, non-agriculture, industries, everything it is comes under this definition. Then global warming potentials, like we researcher are depicted the climate change impact in the global warming potential. So instead of like only a single element emissions, either methane emission or CO2 emission or N2O emission, instead of that, you put it in a common platform. So common platform, common indices, it is the ability to trap the extra heat in the atmosphere over time relative to carbon dioxide. So all these global warming potentials are converted into the CO2 basis relative to CO2, and CO2 taken as one unit. So this is most often calculated over 100 years and is known as 100 year global warming potential. Okay. So global warming potential is calculated by, so whatever the methane emission from the unit area multiplied with the 25, then the nitrous oxide into 298, and finally the CO2 is added to the total sum. Okay, it is one unit, and nitrous oxide 298 times and 25 times methane. Okay, so all these three indices or these three parameters put together, we call it as the global warming potential. Then next, like the term we frequently use or put it in a common unit is the carbon equivalent ratio, or carbon dioxide equivalents is a term to describe different greenhouse gases in a common unit. Okay, so I told in the previous slides also how the CO2 equivalents is worked out for different elements and sector wise. Okay, then CO2 equivalents is 12 by 44, like 12 carbon is the mass of a carbon, and the 12 is the 22 is the for oxygen. Okay, so this 22 by 44 is used as a the carbon dioxide equivalent with the other elements. By definition, a kg of CO2 is worth of 0.2727, that is 12 by 44. If you do it, it will come 0.2727. Then like the carbon equivalent, it is relative to the global warming potentials into 0.2727. Okay, so it looks like calculation of the GWP then multiplied with the CO2. So it looks like very complicated, but actually it is very simple. So only thing is, we need to multiply with the CO2 in terms of carbon. Okay, Then total the greenhouse gas flux is like one took I took a total methane flux. It is IN RI into DI. It is the RI is the rate of CO2 flux in the ith sampling interval. So it is for the research purpose, and how they calculate these the fluxes in a over a period of time. Then DI is the number of days in the ith sampling interval, N the number of sampling intervals. Okay. So for example, if you take from like 120 days or 150 days duration, if you take like 6 or 7 sampling, so all these sampling units, you need to convert that one into a total methane flux. Okay. Then greenhouse gas flux emission per day, how to calculate? So it is a closed chamber model method. It is given in 1986. Then it is the formula. So I given the flux, then methane gas density, then volume of the chamber, how it is, like length into width into height. So volumetric analysis, then surface area of the chamber. I'm going to show how these chambers looks like. Then IH is the height of the chamber. Then like delta C by delta T, it is the increasing rate of methane over a period of time, mean milligram per meter square per day. So within the one chamber, you are going to estimate. Another simple method, it is also given by the Muzio and co-workers in 2016. So what is like how to calculate the individual the greenhouse gas flux? It is DC by DT into VCH by ACH and so on so formula. Okay. So I given what it means, like the difference in the concentration per minute, then volume of the closed chamber area, then molecular weight, then volume of the molecule, then average temperature during the sampling period. So it needs to be considered because of the, it also has significant influence on the CO2, CH4 emission. So over a period of time, how it is flux will be total CH4 is calculated based on the F1, F2, F3 is the sampling period. Likewise, then the age of the seedling, then latest the days after transplanting, then age of the plants from nursery to harvest. Okay. So of course I already explained this one. Then the chemical formula for the other greenhouse gases and their equivalent the global warming potentials under the equivalent. So the carbon dioxide is 1, methane is 25, nitrous oxide is 298. Then for fluorocarbons is 7,400 to 12,200 years, okay, and multiplied by this one. Then hydrofluorocarbons, sulfur hexafluoride, we need to multiply it with this one with the carbon dioxide. And how to, once you know the brief the information about the greenhouse gases, then how to collect the gas samples from various fields. So I'm not talking about the industrial collections. I'm talking about only the agricultural, where agriculture researchers or agriculture predictions, how these different the samples techniques are adopted. Now, one such is what we adopted for my research. It is the transparent acrylic chambers. These are 60 centimeter length, 40 centimeter width, and 60 centimeter height. Okay. So this is what we adopted is locally fabricated transparent chambers. So you can observe the base of the chamber, we have the iron the chamber. Above this, like this transparent the chamber is fitted, and surrounding this chamber we need to put a water to avoid the leakage of gases from the chamber. So you can also observe the fan at the top of the chamber. So it is required to make a uniform the mixing of the gas samples within the chamber. And once you put in the field, so all like 6 to 10 yields should come inside the chamber. Okay. Then how to collect the samples from these chambers? The gas samples are collected at the after putting immediately into the field, that is called 0 minutes, and if it is like convenient or very systematic, you can go for 15 minutes interval, then 30 minutes. Like once you put the chamber into the field, we need to take three times, 0 minutes, 15 minutes and 30 minutes, okay? So you can see like you can put the more number of gas chambers at a time, and subsequently one after the other, we can go for collection of the gas samples. You can see the right hand corner of the slide where the schematic diagram of the gas chamber, okay? Means this gas chamber 15 centimeter, the base of the chamber should go inside the soil. Then another type of the gas collection chambers, it is used in rainfed ecosystem where the crops, in between the crop rows they take. So earlier it is only meant for the paddy area where the plants is not that much height and all plants should come inside. So this particular type of the gas chamber is used in rainfed ecosystem. You can see here also the base is installed into the soil and above that you put a chamber, okay? So here no need to have a like a 1 meter height chamber, only like half a foot the height chamber is enough, okay? So some people also argue that this kind of chambers has uniform the gas because you don't need any the fan to mix thoroughly mix the gas inside the chamber, okay? So you can see the above the chamber, one point is there to extract the gas from the chamber, okay? So these are the chambers at the end of the season or at the crop at the maturity stage, okay? So these chambers are put in between the two rows. So frequently the soil sample, the gas samples are the extracted from these chambers, okay? So this type of the chamber is double walled box chamber. It is also used in like grazing system and like short stature crops, and also in between row crops it can be used. Only thing is it is the encapsulated insulation the double type. And also you can see this kind of gas chambers. One is in the wheat area, another one in maize area, another one is the fallow area. So these kind of the chambers can be used to extract the gases from the chambers, okay? So the periodical, the like we need to have the gas collections, one like twice in a week is more ideal. Of course, it also involves laborious and like time consuming. Once in a week is most ideal to analyze the gas samples. So there are some instruments or sensors are also available in the market where they estimated the gas collection or gas information every 1 hour. Okay, so automated the sensor connected. Like some of the ICRISAT scientists are also using that kind of the gas sensors. Okay, so directly it will measures and automatically it will record in the data loggers. Okay, so those kind of chambers is also available, but this is manual and like the conventional method of collection of the gas samples. Then what are the crops and practices which are responsible for climate change? So we'll discuss one by one. Of course, see this kind of like experiment is very common in most of the like climate change study centers, where you, the one such is done in our elevated CO2 and temperature, the elevated temperature alone, then ambient means whatever the temperature and the CO2 present in the like outside the open top chambers they used, and another one also compare with outside the OTC. These are kind of like the crop performance under different climatic studies, okay? So what we observe is C4 crops, like for example maize, will compete with the C3 weeds. When it is the crops and weeds are associated, then C3 crops with C4 weeds are very competitive under the climatic studies, where increasing CO2 we may expect in the future years, okay? Then it's achieved species show smaller response to elevated CO2 relative to C3 base. Okay. Then the all of us know the difference between the C3 and C4, either plants or the weeds. Those C3 weeds are more very, very highly competitive, or more water efficiency, or more photosynthetic responsive the species, where these kind of the plant species show very small compared to C3 weeds or the crops. Then these the climate with high CO2 would contribute to the success of these weeds, like that is also possible to have a impact on the climate on the these grasses like weeds and crops. Then emission of CH4 from the soil to the atmosphere by the decomposition of soil organic matter, like CO2 is converted into CH4 and it is escaped into the atmosphere in the form of CH4. Okay, it occurs only in the anaerobic conditions. Like some of the literature also, like one is, it is published in Nature Scientific Reports in 2017. Just I copied from and showing CH4, N2 and NO emissions in the traditional production system and no nitrogen application. Okay, so it is like in the broadcast application of the 150 kg of the urea also resulted in higher CH4 and N2O emissions. Okay, compare with like the aerobic method or direct seeded rice, it is like in the international level it is mentioned as ground production system, where you observe lower CH4, okay, then NO, okay, nitrous oxide. So that's why like the method of production also contribute for the these methane or nitrous oxide emissions. Then the seasonal cumulative on CO2, CH4 and N2O emissions from two varieties, two hybrids of rice, okay, and different method of the production system. One is continuous flooding, the second is and wet intermittent irrigations, then flooded and dry intermittent irrigations. So among these three types of production system, continuous flooding, the global as compared to continuous flooded and intermittent irrigations. Okay, so that's why what it indicates means the global, like the greenhouse gases emission as well as the global warming potential is going to increase in continuous flooding as compared to other methods. Okay, another so the good example of how these addition of organic matter into the soil influence on the CH4 emissions, okay, and different duration of the crop. The first, the conclusion what we can make from this graph is, over a period of time, this CH4 emission is going to reduce, and it was irrespective of the whether it is addition of organic matter or without addition of organic matter, the maximum the CH4 emission was observed between 50 to 70 days. Thereafter, it is going to reduce us. Okay, so among that, like the flooded conditions, A and C has more this one, the CH4 emission as compared to like non-flooded conditions. And also you can see the difference between no organic matter and the addition of organic matter. Okay, so like organic matter is also important with respect to CH4 emission. Then the similar observation, it is from the nitrous oxide. Okay, so nitrous oxide and methanes are reverse. Okay, so whenever the methane emissions are more, the consequently the nitrous oxide emission is much lower. Okay, so you can see from this graph. Then from the previous two, the CH4 and nitrous oxide emission, the global warming potential is worked out. So the C type is the organic matter addition flooded conditions having the more the global warming potentials as compared to the non-flooded and without addition of organic matter. Okay, So the global warming potential is increases with the flooding condition as well as the organic matter application. So they worked out the global warming potentials, and also they have analyzed data, the CH4 and N2O. And this is very, very, very interesting, the relationship they have developed. The red color ones showing the conventional crop establishment practice, and the green color one is the improved crop establishment practice. So first observation what we is, like conventional cropping system is always higher than the improved one. Then second one is, then conventional tillage with low residue retention. The first, the bar diagram showing like conventional tillage with low residue retention, then they followed by the high residue retention. So as long as if you the high residue incorporated into the soil, it has resulted in more greenhouse gas emissions compared to the strip planting. Okay, the improved method of strip planting has resulted reduced greenhouse gases. So you can see some of these then pesticide, the production, diesel and farm machineries, fertilizers, manures, raw materials, how they individually contribute to the interrelationship between the below the soil surface and above the soil surface, how different the greenhouse gases are interrelated with this with respect to the emission from the soil surface. Okay, the first one is nitrogen fixing of the plants, then another one is paddy. Okay, how these the nitrification and denitrification takes place within the soil, and when it leads to denitrification, how the gaseous form of the nitrogen is escaped into the atmosphere. Okay, so of course this is the very simple form of the previous slide. So bottom of the table, the slide, you can see how denitrification takes place and nitrification takes place. Okay, so both the cases, the denitrification is the negative effect on the like nitrogen cycle. The N2O is escaped into the atmosphere. So during the denitrification process. Okay, so these are the very informative slide where we can calculate different the inputs used in the agriculture production. For example, fertilizers, herbicides, fungicides, insecticides, and vehicle. So in order to calculate how much is the carbon dioxide equivalent per kg of unit. So for example, if you take urea and nitrogen, it is 5.5 kg CO2 per kg of the nitrogen. If you apply urea form of nitrogen, it like if you use 1 kg, it is literally just 5.5 kg of CO2. Likewise, it has like the emission factors is given for all kinds of the inputs. So while work out the net the greenhouse gas emission from the system, when you use the different kinds of the inputs, you can calculate or relate it with the CO2 equivalent. Thereby, entire the system, we can work out the system greenhouse gas emissions. Okay. Then what are the mitigation measures to overcome this the greenhouse gas emission? Of course, I already explained in the previous slides. Instead of the flooded conditions or transplanted continuously submerged conditions, you go for aerobic rice, direct seeded rice, or less water, labor, and less okay, methane emissions, the SHRAE method. So these are the alternative methods of paddy production system where you can reduce the emission. Of course, like nitrous oxide and methane emission from the transplanted rice and the direct seeded rice. We also worked out how much percentage of the greenhouse gases or global warming potentials we can reduce by switching over from transplanted to direct seeded rice. So about 70% of the global warming potential in transplanted rice was due to the emission of methane. So rest is from the nitrous oxide. Okay. Then global warming potential in rice was 728.1 kg CO2 equivalent per hectare in DSR and 1922 kg CO2 equivalent in case of transplanted rice. You can observe how much we can reduce just by switching over from transplanted rice to DSR. Okay. So likewise, overall global warming potentials we can reduce up to 38% in transplanted from the shift over from transplanted to DSR. Then, so of course it is flooding and intermittent flooding compared with without application of nitrogen fertilizers, urea and neem oil coated urea. Okay, so it also changes in continuous flooding compared with the intermittent flooding. Okay, so here they reduce the GWP by 25 to 30%. And neem oil coated urea reduces 10 to 12% compared to prilled urea or like uncoated urea. So what are the options we have to reduce the these emissions from the crop productions? Management of plant nutrients, for example, like modified form of fertilizers, manures according to needs of the crop. Okay. Then site specific nutrient management or like location specific or field specific fertilizer application is very, very important in this aspect. Then leaving the crop residues in the soil, reduces slash and burning system. We can adoption of conservation agriculture also reduces the greenhouse gas emissions. Likewise, then avoid the further deforestation in the already existing forest area, that also reduces the CH4 emission. Then we talk about the greenhouse gas emissions from livestock. How we can reduce it? One is the improved animal feeding management, manure management, then selection of the potential breeds where the conversion of energy is very high, and replacing the low producing breeds with the high yielding breeds, that is also possible to reduce or reduce the wastage of the feed. Then management of crop production only for the feed, then better grazing management in the western countries. These are the options. So these are the basic like some of the literature issues, like information and basic information regarding GSEs. Now, what are the our experiences from US Raichur, where we conducted and what is the brief the outcome of our research? We conducted at three locations. One is at the middle region, the head region at Gangavati, middle region at Dadesugur, and the tail end for in the Raichur region. Okay, how these influence location specific, then the amount of water they give, all those things we started with the spatio-temporal analysis and modeling of greenhouse gas emissions in paddy ecosystem under varied water and nutrient management. This is a project funded by DST. So we already completed this trial. What we done is direct seeded rice with DSR, stream method and transplanted rice. We followed four method of the establishment methods and the water management, alternate wetting and drying, critical stage, saturation and farmers practice. And also we conducted irrigation schedule based on IWCP on drip fertigation. So it is completely agronomic investigation, how it influence on the greenhouse gas emissions we estimated. So these are the chambers we adopted for our research. You can see at a time we installed 8 gas chambers in research field. Okay, so 8 gas chambers at a time, and you can collect the gas samples from these chambers at a time. Okay, and you can also see vials where the glass vials is used to collect the gas samples and bring it to the lab. Okay. So all gas samples we analyzed from the pesticide residue laboratory. So we have the fantastic facility at Raichur, and we also outsourced this sample analysis. The gas collection from the fabric gas chamber, and we analyzed using gas chromatography. And another one is like before the establishment technique, we need to control seepage of water, because we are also estimated how much of how much quantity of water is used for each establishment methods. In order to calculate the total amount of water and water efficiency, we installed these plastic papers. We installed up to 1 feet depth. So in order to avoid lateral seepage of water, then within that plot, we established the paddy in 4 method of establishment. Then we also the drip irrigation schedules, fertilizer levels in paddy. So we conducted this 2 years. So what are our brief outcome from this experiment or this project? Then total GHG emission is kg per hectare. It is more in TPR than SWI, wet DSR and dry DSR. Okay. Then also we also estimate like worked out the carbon equivalent from the establishment methods as well as like irrigation scheduling. Then greenhouse gas emission from rice establishment methods. So over a period of the from beginning to end of the season. So we collected 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 samples during the period of the 130-150 days. Okay. So you can see the maximum what we observed up to 60-100 days. Okay. Then among all these, the transplanted rice looks or gives high CH4 emission, N2O emission, and CO2 emission. So similarly with the irrigation schedule as well as the fertigation treatments, we worked out the CH4, N2O, and CO2 emission. So we also developed the relationship between the CO2, N2O, and CH4 emission with the grain yield. Okay. So these are the regression equations we developed. The top one is for DSR, then the wet DSR, stream method, and transplanted. Okay. So you can observe how the relationship between these the greenhouse gases and the grain yield. These are the regression equations. And we also developed the equations for the irrigation scheduling, alternate wetting and drying. Okay. Then critical stage irrigation, saturation level, and farmers irrigation practice. So this is the total water applied, and that is the in CO2, N2O, CH4 emission, the relationship. So this right side, you can see each the relationship with the regression equations. Then apart from that project, we also having another project funded by ICR NICRA. We also estimated the collected the gas samples from the different fields. And apart from rice, we also collected the gas samples from the crops in the paddy fallows. So what are our the major conclusions is the puddling and transplanting is a major source of methane emission, contribute around 10-20% of the total. Then among the alternative techniques, DSR has the potential to reduce the greenhouse gas emission. The greenhouse gas emission up to a tune of 20-25%. Then apart from rice, the arable crops was found more efficient. Instead of like rice followed by rice, if you go for arable crops in the paddy fallows, it is more productive and economic efficiency, water efficiency, energy productivity, and okay. So and also reduce the greenhouse gases. Then in the paddy fallows, arable crops utilizing the residual moisture, wherever it is not possible to have a second crops, you can go for arable crops with minimum water. So that is possible to have the potential cropping system, and you can reduce the greenhouse gas emission. So we like apart from the researchers and the associates, we also have a scientific team. It also includes Mastan Reddy from like rice agronomist from ARS Gangavati, then Jagadish, then Chittapur sir, then Rajkumar, Ramesh, Anand, Prashant. These are the like the scientists and the students associated with our DST project. So thanks one and all for your attention. If you have any questions or any clarifications or want to discuss something more, so you're all welcome. Thank you one and all.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot for your lovely presentation. Now, if we have any questions, sir is here with us, please ask.
You can also note down my email. If you have any clarifications or want something information, you can also have contact in the future also.
Any questions? Yeah, there is one in the chat, sir. How to estimate N2O carbon footprint in soil and plant?
Yeah, right. Relevant questions, and we also working on these things in the ICR NICRA funded projects. Like the carbon footprint means it has to be estimated. The carbon, like one slide I showed, all the inputs and the outputs has to be accounted in and converted into carbon equivalents. Then carbon like input and output together, and you can estimate how much is the carbon left over in the soil and all other details. It is like a kind of another like bank accountability. It is the carbon accountability.
Hello.
Yeah.
Can I ask sir one question?
Yeah, sure.
Sir, as you know that sir, we have vast livestock population in India. So how much okay. You agree that we are blamed that we produce more that methane as compared to other country? Because in the rural area, mostly the livestock population situated in the rural area, very few large dairy farms over there in India. So I don't think, sir, we are culprit for producing that global warming.
No. So like I told in the previous slides also, like minimum it is from the agriculture background. If you like the global warming or the global warming potential, the major contributor from the industries.
Yes.
CO2 is the source from the industries, and minimum it is from the agriculture.
And how much, sir, that livestock, how they will contribute? How much contribution from livestock?
Yeah, I told in the different sectors how much it is contributed. It is only 13% it is contributed to the total global warming potential.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sir, good afternoon, sir. Very nice presentation. So myself, Dr. A.V. Jensi Sinio, sir. Sir, what in nutshell, what measures we should take to reduce this one, sir, greenhouse emission from especially for livestock, sir? What measures we can we have to take, sir?
So I told in the like a couple of slides where the options we have. Like one is like manure management. Another one is the breed management.
Yes, sir.
We have to look at the like low yielding and low productive animals has to be substitute or the replaced with the high energy efficient breeds, and yes, also sir. Like the feed management or manure management.
Yes, sir.
Those really contribute for this one greenhouse gas emission and yes, subsequently with the global warming potential.
Sure, sir. So we can reduce that population of that livestock, no, sir? So we have to substitute,
yes.
Reduce that low-yielding animals for high-yielding animals, sir. We have to do.
Yeah. Yes, energy sir. Efficient and more productive ones.
Productive animals, yes, sir. Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Any more questions? Any clarification?
Please ask. Yes, sir, there is one more in the chat. What is the percentage of greenhouse emissions from agriculture than industry sector?
Yeah, I already mentioned. I will show you that graph here. Each having a different percentage of contribution. You can see this graph. It clearly indicates the global scenario where agriculture and livestock and the other the contributes. Yeah, any other questions? Hello, sir. Hello. Hello. Something went wrong.
Are there any further questions? I don't think there are any further questions, sir. We may consider the session to be concluded.
Yeah, they can note down my email also. They can send it later also. There is no more.
Yes. No issues, sir. No issues. Sir, on behalf of the participants and on behalf of the organizing committee and all the organizing parties, thank you very much, sir, for being with us.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, participants. We may join back tomorrow. Thank you.